Hello, everyone, and welcome to Collider Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Natasha Martinez, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news in the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining us today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Why don't you step into my red room? We all got to go see 50 Shades Darker last night, and it influenced us all just a little bit.
Yes, we're all sultry today.
You're
joining
all
us
on.
For her first time on Movie Talk, Brianne Chandler.
Yay!
Hey! I feel like Katie Heron being asked to sit with the plastics. That's going to mean that you're Regina George, John.
Also joining us, Jeremy John.
I left my gag ball and wrist cuffs at home, but I do have some black leather. Let's have some fun, folks.
And also lucky enough to watch the 50 Shades Darker screening with us last night is Kristian Harloff.
I love how John's like, oh yeah, I'm going to wear this today in honor of this movie, as opposed to walking around in his house with some weird spiked bat.
All day, every day. All right. I don't know. There are some comic book movie fans out there who felt a great disturbance in the force yesterday. Oh, I wonder what that was about. Natasha, why don't you start us off?
Okay. According to a new report from Forbes, it looks as though the Batman standalone for the DCEU is going back to the drawing board. Just as we learned, Ben Affleck was stepping away from the project as director, Justice League and Argo screenwriter Chris Terrio turned in a rewrite on the project. Forbes is now saying that not only is Matt Reeves still at the top of the list as a replacement director, but that WB is also looking to start from scratch again on the script with either a major rewrite or a completely new version. John, thoughts on the news that the Batman movie could be starting over from scratch? Uh-oh.
Wow. Just wow. Okay, look, for anybody at home keeping score, look, when crap happens, we come out here and we say, crap is happening. And for some reason, some people like to say that because we don't turn a blind eye to it, there are some morons out there who will go, you hate DC. Okay, for all you bandwagon morons, when Ben Affleck was announced as Batman, and all of you out there ranted, including this guy.
I did.
Ranted and raved about how stupid of an idea it was to get Ben Affleck. John Schnepp and I got on a video 5 minutes after they made the announcement, talk about what a great idea it was. This is going to ensure the future of DC. He's one of the best filmmakers out there today. As an actor, he's improved so much over the last 10 years. He's going to bring a gravitas. So for all you bandwagoners, just sit down and shut your uneducated little mouths for a second. All right. So nobody has been the bigger DC cheerleader than me. However, when stuff happens, stuff happens. We said about a month ago, look, with everything we're hearing, I'm not going to be surprised if we find out Ben Affleck isn't going to direct this movie after all. And when I said that, I had a bunch of people, you know, tweeting at me and Facebook messaging me and writing me saying, you don't know what you're talking about. You're an idiot. He's on board with this. He's going to direct it. It's going to be great. It's going to be awesome. Fast forward 3 weeks, Ben Affleck ain't directing it. And when I said, uh-oh, this is bad, hit the panic button, those same people who insisted he was going to direct it were saying, no, this is going to be fine. He's still in total control. He's writing the script. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be incredible. You just don't know what you're talking about. I said, no, that ain't the case. And now we find out through our friends over at Forbes, who did a great job of reporting on this, that that script Ben Affleck had written, gone. Oh, it's okay, though. Chris Terrio did a rewrite. Gone. They are back to square one. They're back to square one. Does anybody out there still want to tell me that everything's fine? Does anybody out there want to sit out there and now pretend that no, nothing's wrong. DC has us all under control. Everything's fine. Is there anybody left out there still pretending this? Because if you, look, you should have been bought on this whole idea when we started hearing Affleck sounding negative. Then you should have realized all this with all the Justice League stuff. You should have realized all this when Affleck went off it as the director. And now if you don't buy into it now and understand that no, even if you're like me and you are dying for the DCU to be as awesome as Man of Steel was, if you're still in denial, then just admit you're in denial. It's the only healthy thing to do at this point. This is a ship that is completely rudderless right now. They have no idea what they're doing. They are just floating in the middle of an ocean of complete uncertainty. They're doing one thing, they're doing another. And we're not just talking about moving a release date a couple of months. We're talking about Ben Affleck, the savior, is going to direct it. Now he's not directing. And now the scripts are gone. They had all these plans, all these things down, the Deathstroke stuff, everything gone. And we're right back to square one again. Now, let me say this, though. If you want to find a silver lining in all of this, here's a potential silver lining. And I'm not being facetious either. This is a potential silver lining here. We just recently heard, not long ago, we talked about on the show, that The Flash was getting a complete page one rewrite again. So again, gone, and then right back, page one rewrite. Is this possible? Christian, let me throw this to you first. Is it a possibility here that us hearing that Flash has gone back for a complete page one rewrite, and now it looks like Batman is going back for a complete page one rewrite, could this be a sign that maybe Warner Brothers now has a new overall plan and they're now adjusting all the individual properties to come in line with a new, bigger overall picture? Could there be a silver lining in this?
Well, I'm going to let my friend John Lovitz answer this. Dumpster made fire. it sounds like they don't know what's happening. They don't. You have Ben Affleck. Oscar, at least he should have been nominated, but his film won the Oscar. Up until Live by Night, this is the next coming of the great director. And you think he's gonna have a lock on Batman, because he certainly had a lock on him. I think it was the best thing about Batman v Superman. People
totally
are excited
agree.
About looking yeah. what's gonna happen with Justice League. And I was with Jeremy. I was actually not on board with when he was cast, but he proved me wrong, and I think he proved a lot of other people wrong. But to answer your question, I do think that it might be something to where I hope that it's just a meeting of the mind saying, listen, the direction that we were going with Flash, with Batman, it wasn't working. Terrio and Affleck and the Flash writers, everybody over there, they're going in a direction that maybe the Zack Snyder direction was going, and we don't want to go that direction anymore. So you might be right. And getting Matt Reeves, if they are going after Matt Reeves, you're not going to get a boo from me on that aspect. I think that when he came on to Apes, that was another thing. I was like, oh, man, I really liked the first one. And he crushed Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. And I can't wait to see what he's going to do, because in talking to him, I got a chance to interview him. And talking to him about Dawn of the Planet of the Apes, he's just one of those directors so invested, puts all his time and just thought and understands the material that he's working on. He would be a good choice. The question is were the execs going, we just need somebody to help us. How about the guy who saved Apes? And then we'll just bully him around too. That's what I worry about anytime with these studio things. But I think this could be a positive thing. I do think it's possible that they are trying to revamp the entire franchise. And let's say if they pulled back and said this isn't working, they knew they were going to get the heat for it. Maybe it's a good thing that they said, let's just wait and not rush out the stuff. But I would hope that they would do the same thing with this Harley Quinn movie. Get rid of it. We don't need that movie right now. Let's get the entire universe set in motion before we just start throwing standalone movies because a character is popular.
Now, this whole Matt Reeves thing, which, by the way, if they end up getting him on, he's a great director. But the wording of it was, our number one target right now is Matt Reeves. It feels like me in high school saying, yeah, I'm circling the hottest girl in school to take to the prom right. this week. Meanwhile, the hottest girl in prom is hearing this and saying, well,
tell him you're my cousin.
Yeah. I have no idea what this guy's talking about.
Right.
I have no idea what this guy's talking about. And I just wonder what Matt Reeves was thinking about all this. Anyway, Brianne, you've seen all of this drama unfolding. As a fan of film, what is your perception of all this right now?
You know, when I first heard the news about this, I was a little bit excited to come here today because it was like the Grinch, that smile that like kind of curls, because I knew that John's head was going to explode and I wanted to see that in person. So thank you. But I just wonder, like, is this the death of Superman Lives? What happened? Do we need John Schnepp to get his documentary crew and like go in and investigate and see what's happening? Although at the same time, I do see that it's okay to take a breath and say, this isn't working, how can we fix it? Why do we have to pump out everything so quickly all the time? That's kind of where I'm at, although I will say, I do want the Harley Quinn movie, personally, because I'm ready for a big screen female presence in the superhero genre.
Sure, but would you take the expense of that, though, if they don't... Don't you think it could be rushed if they don't have an idea of where it goes and fits into the timeline of story? I would much rather them, like, when we're ready for it and it fits into the timeline of what the story is, as opposed to ruining it, and then you can't do a second and third one because you've ruined it because the character's popular. I thought Margot Robbie was great as Harley Quinn. Yes. And I would like to see her in another movie as her. I just think that they're just trying to pick... They don't know what's going on, so they're just trying to pick and match. Eventually, I would like to see it if it fits into the timeline. I just think right now they're grasping at straws.
Jeremy.
Yeah, here I am. When we were going to the screening last night, it was really funny because you turned to me, you were like, did you hear the new Batman news? And you told me what happened. I was like, we're going to 50 Shades Darker. I'm already having a bad day. I mean, come on, why? It's super fascinating. Two perspectives right here. On one hand, and the reality of the situation is everything we knew about Batman that you were pumped for, people were like, oh, we're going to see Deathstroke. Nothing says that now. There's nothing says you're going to see Deathstroke. In fact, I did a video that I should probably take down at this point, which was when DC announced their entire lineup. They're like, here's what you're going to get and when. It's not even applicable at this point. It's not the same plan. So I don't even, that video's still there. If you want to watch something completely outdated, have fun, knock yourself out. But I would like to think that if they're doing this, the reason is, like Christian was saying, that they're just a little offbeat, a little off cadence, like you've said for a long time. Everything they're doing is very reactionary. I would love, the optimist in me would love, a scenario where they're all sitting at a round table like, all right, guys, we're going to scrap everything that's not in post-production like Justice League. It's all going, and we have to rebuild from scratch to really right the ship and get us on a right path. You know, it's like they're Bambi on ice right now, tripping, and they're like, wait, you just kind of... fall for a second, get up, and then you're no longer scrambling on ice anymore. I'd like to think that's what's happening. Christian, what's up?
This is why Wonder Woman is so important. Mm-hmm. I think the Wonder Woman movie, that's like, this is why you go back to a female-driven super. You're getting it, and you're getting it with Wonder Woman, and I'm excited. She's going to, that is the one, that fits into the timeline. That is the movie that
Because it's outside of the timeline.
Yeah.
But it ultimately is going to add into what she adds to Justice League, and that movie is one of the most important movies that are going to happen right now, because I think decisions are going to be made after that particular movie.
Yes.
Now, if there are movies, there are characters that pop into that film that could spin off, that's where I get interested in. If there's other characters that come in, I'm just worried about what they're doing as a plan. That's why Wonder Woman is so important in July when that movie comes out to shape the rest of the DC universe.
Right. I still think, aside from a movie called Star Wars, I think it's my most anticipated film of the year.
Right, absolutely. Because that was the Comic-Con crusher right there, trailer.
And that trailer was incredible.
Right, and they had a Justice League trailer also, which makes me think, I would rather they commit to what they have to Justice League rather than it be glaringly like, okay, this is where all the reshoots and rewrites happened halfway through Justice League being finished. I'd like to just, all right, do that, and then from then on, right the ship, hopefully. I mean, this is me saying that they're righting the ship. It could be a case of they're like, we don't know what we're doing with Batman, and so we're just, or the Flash, and it's just going up and down and dying. Flash was bad enough, but Batman was the thing that we could all look at and be like, yeah, but we still have Batman. That's going to be great.
It was our ace in our
sleep. Right, right, right.
For those of us who've been trying to defend, because when I get the Marvel fanboys coming at me, everything DC sucks, we always had that ace up our sleeve.
Yeah.
The Batman directed by Ben Affleck movie is coming. That was always the ace up the sleeve. Now, let me ask everybody at the table this question. And I mean this honestly. Is there anybody in here, is there anybody in this room that believes for one second that the departure of Ben Affleck as the director of this film is not connected to the fact that WB has just thrown out his script and thrown out Terrio's script? Is there anybody in here that believes that those are two totally coincidental, non-connected things?
No, nothing's coincidence, my friend. I'm a detective, like in The Dark Knight.
Batman,
I'm not allowed to believe in coincidence.
Okay, so this wouldn't be a movie talk if I didn't throw at least one over-under.
Oh.
Okay, one simple over-under.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to put it right down the middle. I'm going to put it at 50%, the chances that Ben Affleck even appears after Justice League as Batman again.
Oh my gosh, you're going to kick me in the balls.
Whoa. Wait.
Nobody wants to go first on this?
I don't even know what to begin.
We're all locking up, like looking at each other like, you go first.
I'll go first. Okay. It's over. I think that now, I don't know if it's a different percentage we're playing. Does he want to? I think that whether or not they locked him into a contract for a certain amount of movies, I think that he'll have to do the solo movie for sure. So I'm going to say over.
I am also going to, with the line at 50, if the line was at 75%, I would take under. Yeah. At 50%, I will take over. I think there are contractual obligations here. I think Warner Brothers knows they cannot lose him at this point. So I'm going to very unconfidently go over 50% that Ben Affleck does appear as Batman in the standalone Batman film.
Yeah, I will say, man, locking someone into a contract they don't want to be in just harbors anger. And I would, it'd be a bummer if they did that.
You don't know anything about that.
No, I don't. Not at all. But that would suck if they did that. And I'm going to say 51% he's Batman. It might be 50.5, but I mean, it's a bummer I have to go that low. That is literally me going, it's a coin flip as to whether or not I look forward to a lot of DC stuff again. Lego Batman, go see it.
I don't understand how sports and statistics works, so I'm just going to go ahead and follow your lead and say over. Obviously, there are contracts at work, so I'm assuming that he's locked in for a certain amount of time, which is why I would say we'll see him.
We will continue to watch this drama unfold.
It is like with like CNN, like this just in.
Yeah, like a school bus full of children slowly falling off a bridge. Let's keep our eyes on it. All right, what's next?
According to a report from The Hollywood Reporter, Fox has purchased the rights to the novel A People's History of the Vampire Uprising by Raymond Villarreal and is planning a movie adaptation that will be produced by Sean Levy and Dan Cohen's 21 Laps, the filmmakers behind Arrival and Stranger Things. Pitched as World War Z with vampires, the story is a fictional account of the violent confrontation of vampires with the human race. Like the World War Z novel, the book is told from multiple points of view and spans a considerable time period, tracking a CDC investigator who discovers a mysterious virus that helps create the vampires. A search is now underway for a writer and director with a release date yet to be determined. Jeremy, what do you think about a vampire movie in the vein of World War Z?
I love the fact that it was the World War Z, the book, is what they said. It was like, there was an emphasis on the book. I mean, that sounds like a cool premise, and the brains behind it intrigue me. I'd like to see. It almost sounds like I Am Legend before those were vampires, kind of. They were zombie vampires, but they were vampires, essentially. But not necessarily the movie, but more, you know, it looks like they're going for the literary works that people actually like, not the movies that people are kind of 50-50 on. But a world where vampires are straight up taken over and there's a reactionary like, oh my gosh, the apocalypse is about to happen. It always intrigues me. I like zombie stories. I like me some vampire stories. There's a part of me that wonders how it had, like, is it just, okay, monsters are coming, or is it like vampires are in society and then one day vampires grow at an exponential rate and they're like, ah, we'll screw it, we'll just take out our food supply. That's not very smart, so I don't know why they're doing that. I'm looking forward to this one for sure. And now we know what's taking place of World War Z 2, now that that's just up in the air and no one knows where that is.
You know what? Sean Levy is no longer just that guy who did Night at the Museum. He's done some really cool, interesting stuff. I didn't love Arrival, but everybody loved Arrival and he had his hand in that. Stranger Things, all that kind of stuff. Like, now when Sean Levy gets involved in a project, I actually get really kind of, you know what the first movie was? We talked about this movie a little bit yesterday.
Okay.
The first movie that he did that got me really on board, I want to see what he does next, Real Steel.
I love that. Yeah, we did talk about Real Steel.
Like,
that's right.
I love that movie. And ever since then, he's been kind of on a roll to me. This sounds like it'd be really interesting. You can approach it from a socio kind of idea, like what happens to culture, society, when something radically changes within it. There's a lot of cool ways you can go with this as far as action or deeper thought and philosophy and all that kind of crap. So to me, this sounds really good. Brianne, what do you think?
I love vampires aside from Twilight. So any sort of vampire property, of course, Buffy Summers is one of my favorites. But I read up a little bit about this, and it seems like it's not just about the CDC person that kind of discovers that these vampires are coming out. It's going to be from other perspectives as well. An FBI agent that was assigned to the, like, gloaming crimes unit, which is, the gloaming is what they call the vampires. A librarian at the Vatican is going to be, like, one of the perspectives that you see this all from, as well as, like, a TMZ reporter. It's random stuff. And I was like, that's kind of interesting, actually. And it being the predecessor to something like I Am Legend. I loved I Am Legend. I love Will Smith.
Right. Oh, I was going to say, you know what's funny about that is that's a lot of perspective that you just threw out, and I'm glad you looked into that, because, I mean, it looks like it would be better as a show or a streaming service, because that's a lot of perspective.
It sounds like a show,
yeah,
for
and
sure.
There's so much vampire stuff coming out for television as well. I think Anne Rice is trying to do, like, the Vampire Chronicles, get that going. We have Let the Right One In that might be a TV property as well, so you... We're seeing vampires all over the place.
Christian.
And we've been seeing them for a long time. That was my initial kind of like, more vampire stuff. It's just like, is it so much stuff, whether it's from True Blood to Twilight and all these. There's so many different, and even...
Vampire Diaries,
all of it. I mean,
Last
there's so,
Night.
There's so much vampire stuff to where it's starting to get watered down with the announcement of Anne Rice and everything too. But Sean Levy makes me go, okay, I'm interested. Because Arrival was my favorite movie of the year. Stranger Things, he had his hand in that. You mentioned Real Steel. He gets himself involved in projects that he can make fun, make creative. And, you know, obviously Arrival and Stranger Things wasn't just him, but he certainly had his creative thoughts involved, and that's what he's going to be doing with this show. So I'm willing to say, all right, I want to see what Sean Levy's going to do with this premise, because any premise, even ones that have been done to death, can be done differently when you bring in a different creative talent. So I'm very interested to see what he's going to do to this.
All right, guys. Well, listen, it is Thursday, which means it's time for us to talk about what is opening this week in movie theaters. We already talked last week, or on Tuesday, about 50 Shades, which is a shame. I'd love to talk about that again.
You're already hoping it was long, way farther back than it was.
And, of course, John Wick 2, which is awesome. But there's another film dropping this week. Natasha, what is it?
The Lego Batman movie. There are three big changes brewing in Gotham. There are big changes brewing in Gotham. But if Batman, voiced by Will Arnett, wants to save the city from the Joker's hostile takeover, he may have to drop the lone vigilante thing, try to work with others, and maybe, just maybe, learn to lighten up.
This movie is fantastic. There's no way around. It's fantastic. And I didn't know, I mentioned this in the review, and you can find our review up on the channel here. But one of the things I said, I was a little bit nervous about it because I was afraid of a Minion situation where the Minions were amazing side characters in a bigger property with Despicable Me. And then when they tried to use those as in their own film that they had to carry, it didn't work out so well. Batman in the Lego movie was an incredible side character. And I was afraid that if they tried to take that Will Arnett Batman and give it his own film, that the shtick might get tired or whatever. No problems. It stays fresh and funny throughout. You must go see this movie. My big conflict right now is I am having a hard time deciding what to recommend people to see first, whether it's John Wick 2 or the Lego Batman movie, because they're both just excellent. But one of the things, we've talked about this around the office too, when you watch this movie, as silly and spoof-filled and ridiculous and fun as it is, when you watch it, one of the things you will walk out of the movie with is an appreciation of the filmmakers behind this movie truly have a deep understanding of the character of Batman. In order to do all that spoof stuff they did, they had to have a core understanding of Batman, which they really do, maybe better than any other. It rivals the understanding of Batman of Christopher Nolan. I mean, it's just on that level, but it's just a fun, entertaining ride that adults will love, kids will love. You got to go see it. And Christian, you saw the film too. What did you think?
I loved this movie. And for all the reasons that you're saying, but also the fact that not only do they understand Batman, they understand humor, they understand how to tell a spoof story, but still keep a core story with emotion there too, because there's a lot of that in this movie. And what I will tell you about the Lego folks is that they are starting to create something. Now, before you go crazy and say, how dare he compare the two, when Pixar started on their run, they came out the bat, you know, with Toy Story, and then they started to tack on stories that you're like, oh, wait a minute, this is a viable company. Lego now, with their two movies, with Lego Movie and Batman Movie, we'll see how Ninjago does before we start claiming them as the top animation company, but they are doing it right. They are telling stories that adults can enjoy, and I can tell you from a parent of a five-year-old, it is appropriate for her also. It's appropriate for young kids, because I was worried about maybe because Batman could be dark in his nature. Maybe they were going to throw some of those things in there, but they did it in such a way. My daughter's running around. She's like, she told my wife this morning, there are bad guys in this, but they're goofy. and that's the perfect explanation. Like that, it's fun, and they do understand Batman, and they do get it, and they spoof it with love. It's like watching Friends roast It's like, you know that there's love behind it and what's really there. And I think that this was just it's a feel-good movie, and I look forward to seeing what Lego can do next.
Brianne, have you seen the movie yet?
I have not seen the movie
yet. Are you looking forward to it?
I am so looking forward to this. My son loves the Lego movie. He's 4 years old. He makes me fast forward to the part where Batman shows up in the Lego movie, and we watch from there. He does not want to see the beginning parts because he doesn't care. He loves Batman so much. And we love the series that's on Netflix that's like the Batman animated Lego version with Troy Baker as the voice as well. So I'm looking forward to this. I already know what order I'm seeing all these films this weekend, unfortunately. So I'm hoping to see Lego Batman on my birthday. So that's coming up. But my kids are excited. I'm excited. I'm just loving what Lego's putting out right now. And Ninjago, like, I watched the Ninjago series with my kids on Netflix. So I'm also looking forward to that.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I feel like the order is two movies this weekend that you should see. And that shit, I'm just...
I already got my tickets, Jeremy, late on that.
Best comedy of the year.
I pray for you. But no, Lego Batman's great, and it's a great Batman movie with none of the script rewrites or director drama. That's good. That's a lot of fun. Hey, if you want a great Batman movie, it's actually coming out to screenings tonight and then this weekend. No, and you really hit the nail on the head. They understand Batman. That's not to say the movie doesn't have his exaggerations, but in order to spoof and exaggerate a character, a premise, and a world, you have to understand that character to know where to turn this up and where to really focus on that and just make it a little more ridiculous than, let's say, The Dark Knight or something like that. And you really see that come through. Like, the dynamic between Batman and the Joker, there's a scene I was just dying laughing. I was like, this is fantastic. This is an understanding of Batman and the Joker. I can't praise Lego Batman enough, honestly. Between that and John Wick 2, I would say Lego Batman over John Wick 2 if you had to see one movie this weekend, but John Wick 2 is a great sequel. Definitely worth watching, and I'm really glad those two movies are the only movies coming out this weekend.
All right, guys, we've reached that part of the show for Buy or Sell. Here's how this works. In front of her, Natasha's got a few other items in the world of movie news. She's going to run them down. Then those of us at the table are simply going to say whether we buy it or sell it. So, Natasha, what do we got?
With Paramount officially pulling World War Z 2 off its release schedule, Brad Pitt has an opening in his schedule and is interested in the next film from the immigrant director James Gray, the sci-fi pick Ad Astra. Deadline broke the story that would see Pitt taking on the sci-fi heavy film that tells the story about a slightly autistic engineer whose father left 20 years ago on a one-way mission to Neptune in order to find signs of extraterrestrial intelligence. As an adult, he sets out to travel the solar system to find his father and discover why his mission failed. A summer production start date is being eyed for the film. Christian, buy or sell the sci-fi movie Ad Astra with Brad Pitt.
There's not much for me to sell here. It's a big buy. I'm a sci-fi fantasy junkie. So sci-fi junkie when it comes to brand new sci-fi, things I haven't heard before. And I'm a Brad Pitt fan. I think he's a really great actor. I think sometimes underrated actor. And I think that this is a type of story that he would excel at. There is the risk that this could be incredibly boring, but there's also a chance that it's new. It's something that we always ask for. Where's the brand new stuff? Let's get away from Star Wars. Let's get away from Marvel. Let's try brand new science fiction movies instead. And here we go. So let's see how it goes. Let's see how it turns out. It's always about the first trailer, obviously, too. But when you give me this type of premise with someone like Brad Pitt, I say, okay, tell me more.
Brianne?
Based on the premise, I'm going to buy this. Pretty much if you put anything in space, I'll see it. Jason X is a prime example of that. But
what's the love one that was just out last week
with
the kid
from
Mars?
Oh, that one.
Yes.
Take your words back.
I actually am okay. I would actually be interested in seeing that film just for research purposes.
Or if you need to take a nap.
Yeah. You know, whatever gets me to sleep these days, because I don't sleep, unfortunately. But I love Brad Pitt. I like what you're saying about, you know, we need original things coming out, and this is definitely something that I buy.
Jeremy.
Yeah, it's a simple conversation. It simply is buy. You know what I like about this is it's sci-fi, but it doesn't take take place outside the solar system. That's always a, usually sci-fi is like, oh, we're gonna traverse deep space and Star Trek it up or Star Wars it up and go to another galaxy. This goes to Neptune. That's the outer planet in our solar system, not counting the dwarf planets. And it doesn't go past that. And it, I mean, it's a research. It seems very sci-fi, but grounded in science that we know of, and so that makes it a little more real. In fact, movies like this, I have a problem calling it sci-fi. It's kind of like Interstellar. A lot of it, although it's more sci-fi than this, it's on the fringe where you're like, yeah, but it's conceptual things that people are actually hammering out in rooms right now. And so, well, I like myself a science film, and that's what I'm going to see this as, a science film.
All right, what's next?
Focus Features has released the first trailer for Sofia Coppola's new film, The Beguiled. The movie is based on the Thomas Cullinan novel of the same name and stars Nicole Kidman as the headmistress of a seminary for young ladies in Civil War era Virginia. The school's seclusion is disrupted when a wounded soldier from the Union Army, played by Colin Farrell, arrives and causes problems. The film also stars Kristen Dunst, Elle Fanning, Anguri Rice, and Una Lawrence, and opens in theaters on June 30th. Brianne, buy or sell the first trailer for Sofia Coppola's The Beguiled.
I am so excited for this. I love costumed dramas. I love that Kirsten Dunst. This is like the most excited I am for a costume drama since like Little Women, Kirsten Dunst. And I love that this is her third collab with Sofia Coppola. This was also the third collab between Don Siegel and Clint Eastwood when this movie was originally made. Mm. So I'm really interested to see what happens here. And Colin Farrell, always love him. I'm definitely buying this.
Jeremy.
Yeah, man. I mean, when I saw Colin Farrell was in it, I was like, oh, shoot, that's Colin Farrell. Let's do it. And take it from me, ladies. You give Colin Farrell a sponge bath, you are helpless to resist. I can tell you that right now. It really looks dark. You don't know what it is. You're like, is this a romance? What is it? And then you're like, oh, you mean like this is kind of a, it's a very...
Is he a hostage?
Yeah,
he
right.
Could be.
You don't know. It's, I mean, this dude comes into this like all girls school or convent or something, and it totally shakes it up. They're like, nope, that can't stand. And it just, it looks like, is he a captive? I have no idea. But when the trailer ends, you're like, I'm creeped out, but I want to see it, you know? It looks like a very dark film directed by a very talented director, Sofia Coppola, so bring it on.
Christian.
I loved this creepy trailer.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a buy for me because I didn't know what to expect. And Sofia Coppola is sometimes a hit or miss for me because somewhere I wanted to jump out the window, but I actually enjoyed Bling Ring. Some people didn't like that, but I actually enjoyed that movie. So I want to see what she's going to do with this. I got a Misery vibe at the very end.
Right.
Mm. At the very end of it because I didn't know what was happening in the beginning. True. It's like, is this a Little Woman thing? Like, what's happening? And then you see him kind of stirring things up. And I was like, oh, is he going to fall in love with, is it going to be a Lolita thing? Because he's going after Fanning here. But then it's like, no. It's
is
not
it Dogtooth? Can he not leave until the Dogtooth comes
right.
out?
Yeah, yeah. So I was like, what's happening now? How are they going to spin this? And then it looks, and Colin Farrell is like probably my top like five favorite actors today. So I like when he plays like these darker characters. It looks like he's going to. It doesn't look like he's a good dude in this particular one. And it was funny because when Nicole Kidman was kind of leaning back in this trailer, and it looks like she's going to be front and center, kind of pulling all the strings with the key. It's intriguing.
All right, what's next?
According to The Wrap, Oprah Winfrey is re-teaming with her The Butler director Lee Daniels for a remake of the 1983 Oscar-winning drama Terms of Endearment. Paramount Pictures secured the rights to the project for Daniels to develop with Winfrey in negotiations to star in the role of Aurora, the difficult mother originated by Shirley MacLaine. Work will begin on the script with a release date yet to be determined. John, buy or sell a remake of Terms of Endearment with Oprah Winfrey and Lee Daniels.
Oh, I buy this huge. This could be great. Now, for those of you out there who are trivia nuts, correct me if I'm wrong, but I also believe that Terms of Endearment, the original with Shirley MacLaine and Deborah Winger, was the last time that two actresses from the same film were both nominated for Best Lead Actress. Plenty of films that had Best Lead Actress and Best Supporting Actress, but I believe Terms of Endearment was the last one to actually have that happen. So, it begs the question, if Oprah is going to be in this film, she's probably going to play the Shirley MacLaine role. Right. Who will they get to come in and play like the Deborah Winger role? This just sounds great. And Lee Daniels is a great director. So this sounds great to me. For me, it's a buy.
Yeah, it's a buy also. And I love Terms of Endearment. It's a great movie. If you haven't seen it before, you should check it out. But this is a good cast. And Oprah Winfrey, I'm overusing the word here, but she's also an underrated actress. When she delivers, man, she delivers. She was great in The Butler. She's great. She has been something else. She's been powerful. She's a powerful force in general. But when she teams up with Lee Daniels, and I think that the butler, I thought, was good. I didn't think it was great, but I think that he gets the best out of her. So this is a movie that I think, once again, he could get the best out of her. And this is a good... So a lot of times, I was like, I don't know why they need to remake this particular movie. I think it would be very interesting to see this told from Oprah Winfrey and just to do it from African-American point of view. I think it would be very interesting. So I'm going to buy it.
Jeremy.
Yeah, there's a lot of pressure behind that because, I mean, a lot of times in the remakes, you can remake Point Break. And as much as the remake was horrible...
Apparently they can't.
Yeah.
They did. It's called Fast
Five. Well played.
Five.
Well played. Yeah, right. It's Fast and Furious. It's totally Point Break. But, I mean, you know, if you do that, you're like, well, I mean, Point Break was a fun movie, but it's not like it's some multi-Academy Award nominated film. This is. And so I feel like if you're going to remake it, you have to push that up. And so there's a lot of pressure behind it, but I feel like he can do it. Like this director can do it. This is a dude who did
Precious
is the one I'm looking for. Yeah, that movie messed me up.
That was the theme song, by the way.
Yeah, Precious. Sure was. We're remaking everything here, folks. We remake theme songs.
Directed by Sapphire.
It's going to be on my YouTube channel in about 5 minutes. That's going to be my new shtick, remaking theme songs. But yeah, I think that if it's going to happen, this they can do it. 11. They got like 11 Academy Award nominations,
Precious?
Something like that.
Yeah
not
Five
Precious.
Wins.
No, the Terms of Endearment. Yeah,
it had tons of them.
So, I mean, pressure's on, so good luck, guys, but I feel like you can do it.
Brianne.
I'm going to buy this. I'm very excited about it. I actually watched Terms of Endearment last night, or at least a portion of it, because I have kids and they wake me up at midnight, so I can't watch it all the way through. And
was it on randomly?
It's on. If you have Amazon Prime, you can watch it for $0. So that was nice. I was able to do that. I'm looking forward to this. I feel like Gabrielle Union could be really interesting in the Deborah Winger role. That would be my pick, personally. And, it's big shoes to fill, but I think they can definitely fill them. Could this be the next, like, one that's going to win Best Picture? Maybe. That next remake? I mean, The Departed did it before.
I like your suggestion, but I also think Gugu Mbatha Raw would be good also. Like if you had like those are both. I think I got that right, the pronunciation. But I do like the Gabrielle Union pick.
All right, listen, as we mentioned, John Wick 2 opens this weekend, and you really need to go out and see it. It's a ton of fun. But the filmmakers behind it, the studio behind it, they issued a little bit of an invitation. So we sent our own Peri Nemiroff to go down to be put through her assassin paces. Check this out.
Having you guys come in today, it's kind of a fun experience for us. We like taking people and transforming and making heroes. And a challenge to our choreography team is to take any one of you and within a short period of time, do cool stuff with you, or find what fits. Our choreography team, their job is to make heroes out of you guys. So if they can pull that off in 10 minutes, we've got the right guys here.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi guys.
Keanu put in 3 months. This is after he's already done 30 action films over the past 20 years, but he put in 3.5 solid months for John Wick 2. I mean, training 6 hours a day, going to the gun range twice a week, and he was killing it. So if you have an actor and actress that's willing to do the squeeze, then they'll be able to drink the juice. And that's the hard part, is finding someone that's willing to do it, to put in the time.
It's nothing.
95% of what the average audience member knows of gunfight is from film. And we believe that 90% of what you see on film is incorrect. So all we did is went back and did it correctly. So it may look like John Wick is doing new stuff. That's pretty real.
That's it.
So we just did the correct route, and we had an actor that was willing to learn. So when you see it, you think it's new. It's just the way it's been going on for 50 years, but no one took the time to do it. So that's our secret.
Look what I just did.
One of the biggest problems in our aspect of the action design of the business is fragmentation. We make you good at the gun range, we make you good at this, we make you good at that, but none of that is on camera. We have to take all this training that we give you and make you look good to it, make you aesthetic, make it pleasing, make it cool, you know, make you believable.
Well, I'm probably not going to deny Perry that raise she was asking for. John Wick 2, once again, opens this weekend. Make sure you guys go and check that out. Hey, listen, I want to let you guys know, too, this show is done live. So at the end of each live show, we like to save a little bit of time to take your live Twitter questions. Start tweeting in your questions now. Make sure you're following us on Twitter, @ColliderVideo. Start sending them in, and Wendy will get to a couple of those as we get near the end. But I also want to remind you that Movie Talk is not the only show that we do here on Collider Video. a brand new Collider Jedi Council with this man, Kristian Harloff. Goes up a little bit later today. Keep your eyes open for that. Also, yesterday, a brand new episode of Nightmares aired, and tomorrow, the Inner Geekdom Championship in the Movie Trivia Schmodown between Robert Meyer Burnett and Hector Navarro goes online. You will want to check that out. And of course, a brand new episode of Awesome-tacular with Jeremy Jahns. And we've got a special guest on this week. Allison Hayslip from G4 fame is on the show with this week's Awesome-tacular episode. So you're going to want to keep your eyes open for that. Make sure you follow that. You can go inside for the Verizon Go 90 channel, the Verizon Go 90 app. You can find it there. And also we'll have links in the description. There's Allison right there with Ken Knapsack and Jeremy.
And the creep
Josh
on the right.
Oh my gosh, that was so much fun. So make sure you guys check out Awesome-tacular with Jeremy Jahns. All right, now before we get to the Twitter stuff, we also like to do mailbag. Listen guys, if you've got a topic or a question you'd like us to address on the show, just email us anytime at collidervideo@gmail.com. Natasha, what's in the mailbag today?
Johnny writes, what female villain in a superhero movie we haven't seen do you want to see pop up on the big screen next? Love everything you guys do. Thanks for taking my question.
You know, there's not a great list of all-time great female villains that we've seen in a lot of movies. A lot of times they give the big juicy villain roles away. Well, unless you want to go Mama from Goonies. She was pretty awesome.
Mama Fratelli?
Yeah, you want to get Mama? She's pretty good. The one that really opened my eyes to a modern film that was like how badass and great elite female villain could be was Lena Headey in Dread.
Oh, yeah, she's great.
Like,
yeah.
She was incredible as that. As far as like comic book villains, I mean, we were just talking about Wonder Woman earlier. Yeah. Cheetah.
Yeah.
Do you guys have any others in mind?
Mine that I was thinking was Dark Phoenix, because it's Jean Grey, but she has...
We kind of saw Dark
Phoenix
already?
We have never seen Dark Phoenix ever.
The real
you know
Dark
what's
Phoenix.
Funny? Oh my gosh, you're right. She has been on screen, but when I thought it, I was like, great, we've never seen Dark Phoenix. I totally forgot about X-Men 3. That's how... Dark Phoenix,
good.
That's my
yeah,
answer.
Yeah, but that whole timeline was pretty much...
Yeah, it's scrapped anyway.
Out,
so and plus, with all the Bryan Singer on and off, we'll never see Dark Phoenix. I want to see Dark Phoenix.
Yeah, I was going to try to say Granny Goodness, but we've seen her on screen in Smallville, so there's that. Can you think of any?
You know, I looked up some. Roxy Rocket sounds pretty cool. I guess she's a Hollywood stunt double that turns into a thief. or the White Rabbit. She can, like, change herself into, like, two different bodies. I don't know. And Sin, who's a Marvel villain, who's the daughter of Red Skull.
I think that it's... I know that it's been done once before, but I'm not counting it. It doesn't count. I would like to see Poison Ivy actually be represented correctly.
Yeah.
That would be nice. I think that I'll flip away from the... and the same thing with Catwoman. I'd like to see Catwoman again. I think Anne Hathaway was fine, but I'd like to see what they do this time in the DC.
Yeah, well, Catwoman's been in many times.
She's been in many times, but I'd like to see a new version of her with this brand new DCEU that they're doing. But if I go from more of a... I'll go into my comfort zone in Star Wars. I wouldn't mind seeing Mara Jade. I wouldn't mind seeing... Asajj Ventress. I think those would be really interesting to see them in the Star Wars universe. So
I think with Mara Jade, that'd be awesome too.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
George writes, Collider Crew, now that Pandora and Star Wars are getting theme parks, what other property or shared universe do you think needs a theme park next? Thanks.
Well, I mean, it's hard to say. Look, I'm not the biggest Harry Potter guy. I enjoy the Harry Potter movies. I'm not a big Potterhead. But, you know, when right down the street from us here is Universal, and they have their Harry Potter... What do they call it? They go... Potterland?
Wizarding World of Harry Potter.
The Wizarding World of Harry Potter.
Wendy just straight up threw some truth this way.
Like, I'm not a Potter guy, but I go into the when I go to the Wizarding World of Harry Potter, because then I have season passes to Universal there, I'm blown away. I am absolutely blown away, whether you're going into the restaurants or whether you go just walking down the street when you go into the castle. I mean, you really do feel like you've been taken into the world of the movie. It's so impressive. And all it did was got my mouth really watering for this Star Wars land. Mm-hmm. As far as what other worlds they should create, it's difficult. I mean, I'm not really sure. I mean, I guess you could do... This one could work. If one of the parks wanted to dedicate a bunch of acreage and do a Middle Earth land.
Yeah. That's what I came up with too. It's like Lord of the Rings would be amazing.
Yeah, that would be
great. So you have your Mordor land and you have the Shire over there down the street or something like that. You can buy, you know, ale, Hobbit ale.
And then we can have a guy dressed up as Smeagol and then take pictures with Smeagol. No one likes that idea.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Get Smeagol. Absolutely.
Well, I'll go down the same path, but I'm going Game of Thrones, man. Give me some Game of Thrones.
It's
similar to Lord of the Rings, obviously, but.
Bring the kids.
Bring the kids to this place. I think you know you'll probably wind up showing up in that mask. But I think that this could be something that's capitalized off it, and something else could be Marvel. I mean, it'd be interesting if you walk into places.
Isn't that called New York City?
Right, but I think you suppose Stark Tower. If you had Stark Tower, and maybe there's Asgard. Marvel. You know, you could go into a place where everything's big and you're Ant-Man size. You know, there's things that they could do in the MCU that would be very interesting.
Yeah, I've always thought Nintendo Land. You have Mario over here. They're making one. I know that. I heard they are making one. Cool. But I've had this in my head for years because I went to King's Dominion in Virginia and I was on a roller coaster and I was like, it would be so rad if someone made a Mario Kart roller coaster.
Yes.
And that would be. I think that would Nintendo Land. The possibilities are endless. So if they're doing it great, and just keep going with
Grand
it.
Theft Auto Land.
Yes, there you go. That's called life, Chris. Yeah,
it's like the Cars ride, except every once in a while your car is forced to stop and somebody drags you out.
Beat the heck out of you with a hammer.
The only thing I'd be nervous about a Westeros Land or something like that. That's what they call for Game of Thrones. Is that like if you went with your sister or something, they might make you do something, and that doesn't sound fun at all.
We'll just stay out of there. Yeah,
yeah, just stay away. All right. I said we get some time for your live Twitter questions, and we're going to do that right now. Wendy, what have you picked out of the Twitter sphere?
The first one comes from Joe Self, who writes, how does AMC pick which movie is for their prime theater? I'm disappointed that John Wick 2 or even Lego Batman isn't for this week.
I think it's a mixture of different things between, well, first of all, the theater wants to put the movie that's going to get the most attention in there because they charge the highest price because it's their premium experience. Right. And if they think, like, I don't know, like, across the street is an AMC Prime from us. Maybe they are putting John Wick 2 there. But if you're AMC and you think, we believe that the tracking is showing that more people are going to be going to see Lego Batman movie this weekend, and that's going to sell more tickets, then it only makes sense, business-wise, that they're going to want to take that and put that movie in the Prime theater that's going to generate the most revenue for them. That only makes sense. So I'm sure it's a mixture between the theater deciding how much they think will be generated, the deals they make with the individual studios, will the studios put up extra money to have to make sure they get certain placement. So I'm sure it's a lot of different factors. You guys have anything to add?
I worked at a movie theater. I can tell you it is a mixture of both. There's sometimes when a movie comes out, the studio's like, you need to have this movie in that house for X amount of weeks.
Yeah.
And then after that, you can do what you want. And then there are weeks where they can do what they want. And they're like, all right, what's tracking the best? So the highest movie is going to go in that auditorium is absolutely what it is.
All right, what's next?
I just, FYI, I think they're putting 50 Shades in the Prime.
What?
Lego Batman?
Over Lego Batman and John Wick?
Yep. Look, I don't know what it's tracking at. I do. Look, for
that can get awkward. You can see things you might not want to see.
Wine?
Look, yes.
If they sell wine,
Look, I'm sorry, but we all have to prepare ourselves for the possibility that 50 Shades may be. Out of the weekend with Lego Batman and John Wick, is a possibility that 50 Shades may end up being the number one film in the box office.
I think it's number two.
No.
I think it's going to be number two as well. I think it's going to be Batman, 50 Shades, and then John Wick 2. But just prepare yourselves. Just be ready. Brace yourselves. It could be 50 Shades.
Yeah, what I'm saying is in terms of theater revenue, if you have Lego Batman in that Prime Theater versus 50 Shades in the Prime Theater, but they can sell alcohol in the Prime Theater, a lot of ladies, I'm telling you, I was there for all the Twilight movies. I was there for the Sex and the City movies. A lot of wine gets sold in movie theaters, and that's a lot of money.
This is not Magic Mike XXL. Like, you're not going to get those kinds of droves
of women. I'm not saying like it's going to go crazy. I'm saying a lot of wine.
You can still drink wine not in the Prime.
Oh, right? Okay, that doesn't make any sense.
No, I think you can buy your alcohol in the bar they have there.
Right.
I think you can take that alcohol into the Prime.
Mm-hmm. Oh, but only the Prime.
Only the Prime?
Yeah, I believe it's only the Prime.
Get a flask. It's super easy.
All right, get a flask.
All right, what's next?
Caleb Patterson writes, in honor of John Wick 2 coming out, what does it mean when you call a movie self-aware?
How would you describe that?
Yeah, it's like Dread, where it's like, okay, we know we're ridiculous, we know we're super violent, we know we're absurd, we know we're a comic book, we're just going to own it and just do it right. Don't try to be some period piece, don't try to be an art piece, don't try to be like, ooh, we're going to see the character, just know what you are and commit to what you are. When a movie is self-aware, it's the best experience is when you're like, the movie knows exactly what it is.
Fast Five is self-aware.
Right.
Yeah.
They know it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Let's not bring up the Fast and Furious franchise because I am
way a big fan of that, and yeah. so I could just talk the entire time.
But
the
it's
rest
self-aware.
Of the time,
it's
know,
very self-aware. A great,
I
a great example of a film that is not self-aware is 50 Shades.
It is not self-aware
at all. And by the way, when a movie is self-aware, that doesn't automatically mean it'll be good. I've seen lots of movies that are very self-aware and they still end up being very bad.
Right. They're on the right path.
But they're on the right path. If you understand what we are, like we know what our movie is and we are just going to own it and buy into it itself, that's kind of when a movie becomes self-aware.
And like I said before, Magic Mike XXL took that to the next level because like Magic Mike, you know, found those parts that everyone wanted and then put that into their second film. So they were definitely aware of what they wanted to get the box office numbers for.
All right, what's next?
This one comes from Bebs, who writes, "Hey, Wendy, and everybody else. If Ben Affleck does back out from playing Batman, are you still going to be interested in the DCEU?"
Here's the sad thing, and they know this. This is the sad thing. Let me give you a little bit of a sports analogy, okay? I am a lifelong bleed blue and white Toronto Maple Leaf fan. My team sucks. They have since the day I was born. They have since the day I was born. They had that one little window with Wendell Clark and Gilmore and them where they got to the semifinals once. But really, since the day I was born to today, they suck. And the owners of the Toronto Maple Leafs, the hottest ticket in Toronto, if you think it's hard to get Lakers tickets in L.A., one of the hardest tickets to get is Toronto Maple Leaf tickets. And the owners know it doesn't matter how bad the team is, this city will bleed blue and white and they will constantly go. And here's the problem. It doesn't matter if Ben Affleck is in Batman or not. A lot of people out there are suckers like me. I just had the fact that it's a comic book movie and it's got the name Batman on it. They could put Pauly Shore as the new Batman. And I'm still lining up. It's the truth. I'm still lining up to see it opening day.
Most people would on that. What a train wreck.
but most of you would too. Don't deny it. And I think there's a sad part of this where I believe the heads of Warner Brothers are self-aware that there are suckers out there like me who, it doesn't matter what we do to this franchise, a certain amount of them are still going to come out and watch this movie. Unfortunately, the correct answer is no, I won't be interested if they replace Ben Affleck as Batman. But the real answer is yes, I'm still interested, and yes, I'll still be the opening day, regardless of who they put in the cowl. I'll still be there. So I don't know. What do you guys think?
It doesn't always mean that, though, because you're right, though. Batman is bigger than the actor. It's just, it just is. It would cause a lot of, almost nail in the coffin stuff, but it doesn't always mean success. If you just throw Batman in there, because look at what started to happen with the Joel Schumacher Batmans. Mm. I mean, they really started to almost destroy the property. There was not a movie from 97 was when Batman and Robin came out, and then almost 10 years later when Nolan was able to get a hold of 2005 was when he was able to get Batman Begins off the ground and then made us care about Batman again and changed the tone and put that realistic spin on it. So if someone else gets a hold of Batman and does it right, there's always a way to get us excited about it. We will be very skeptical if he leaves.
Yeah, that's just Ben Affleck not being in it, not enough. Just the writers having the script having problems, not enough. Just the director problems, not enough. When you stack all three, it becomes a problem. Am I going to say there's a difference between interested and curious and advocating that the movie's going to be good? I mean, I've seen garbage on YouTube. I'm like, I'm just morbidly curious about this thing, and I'll watch that video. That doesn't mean I'm saying the video is going to be good. Right now, all I can say is at this very moment, I'm worried. I'm concerned.
You're worried that that Ben Affleck wouldn't be doing it?
I'm just worried about Batman
in general.
Right.
Yes.
hey, guys, look, before we wrap it up, I just wanted to mention this one thing. You know, one of my, probably my all-time favorite television show, all-time number one, is the Ronald D. Moore Battlestar Galactica. Mm-hmm. When I was a kid, I loved the original Battlestar Galactica with, of course, Lauren Green, Dirk Benedict, and Richard Hatch. And who played the original Apollo and then appeared again in the new Battlestar Galactica in a different role. And Richard Hatch passed away the other day. And it's just those of you who are like me, when we were kids, we grew up watching this Battlestar Galactica show, it's a real loss. It was so cool to see him in the Ronald D. Moore show as well. And a constant advocate for geek culture and a constant advocate. He was always great to fans. He was always great at showing up at all this stuff. And apparently he passed away a couple days ago, and he will be missed. Anyway, guys, that'll do it for us for this installment of Movie Talk. Thank you so much for joining us. Remember, the most important part of the show is not what we have to say about the topics. It's about what do you have to say about the topics. Jump into the comment section below and leave your thoughts and opinions. I want to thank the people sitting at the table with me. First of all, sitting right here on my right, we got Christian. Christian, where can people find you online?
Well, you can find me at Twitter and Instagram, at Christian Harloff. And like John mentioned before, title week begins with the Schmodown tomorrow, Inner Geekdom Championship, Burnett versus Navarro, then Tuesday, Trek versus Patriots, and then next Friday, the big one, you've got Dan Merle defending the title against John Rocha. Make sure you go and check it out.
And, of course, you're out of council a little bit later today. Jeremy, where can people find you?
You can find me at Jeremy Jahns on YouTube, Twitter, and the Internet. You can find me on my Verizon Go 90 show, Awesome Tacular. A new one drops tomorrow. We have a lot of fun. A new sketch with Allison Hayslip. Be there. You will love it. I don't make a lot of promises in life, but I will say you will enjoy it.
And Brianne makes her debut premiere here on Movie Talk. Brianne, where can people find you online?
Oh, you can find me all day, every day on Twitter, at Miss Movies. You can also find me on YouTube.com/HitOrMissMovies, where I host a show called Film Therapy, and I've had Jeremy Jahns on my show. We talk about how movies affect our lives. So check that out.
Of course, over there, the maskless Natasha. Natasha, where can people find you?
You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at NatashaLexis_.
And, of course, the butterbeer-loving Wendy Lee. Wendy, where can people find you?
You can find me on YouTube at The Movie Couple Channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And you guys can simply follow me on Twitter and on Facebook at John Campion. That'll do it for us, guys. Thanks so much for joining us, and until next time, bye-bye.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.